Morning, everyone. So we are continuing on the study from the book of 1 John, and we have seen till 1 John 2:6. So we'll see from 7 to 11 today. So just before starting, that's the passage for today. Before starting, I wanted to ask a small quiz, so you can take your mobile phones and go to that link. So you got mixed responses. So the primary objective of John writing this letter is, so I gave the choices as that we may grow in faith. So we have, people have opted for that we may be more like him, that our joy may be complete, that we may receive his blessings. The right answer that we find in 1 John 1:4 is saying, I am writing these things to you so that your joy may be complete. It's not that you may love him more, or it's not that you may receive his blessings, that our joy may be complete. So John, not just in the book of 1 John, we also see in the Gospel of John, John is very clear in setting his agenda, giving his objective of why he is writing his letter. So here he is giving a precise objective for writing the first letter of John. And then second objective, second goal that he mentions, that you can find in 1 John 2:1. So some of us have written again, joy may be complete here. Actually, that's the first objective. And some of us have opted that we may be become more like Jesus. That's true, but that's not what the objective that John is giving here. He is giving that we may do not sin. That's a secondary objective that he is mentioning here, specific to chapter 2. So, the clear on what this letter is about, that our joy may be complete, because as Sandeep explained in the first message, gospel brings in the joy of salvation. That's one of the primary product of the gospel, receiving Jesus Christ into our lives, is joy. And we see that particular church was infected with false teachings. And what are the effect of people going into or buying into the false teachings, where they were losing their joy in God? They kind of were asked to believe that you need to know something more. You need to know the secret knowledge. You still have to know something which you do not know now. You can do it by whatever means that the false teachers were giving them. But John is saying, in Christ, he is the word of life. He is the completion. And when you understand this, that Jesus Christ you have everything, then your joy will be complete. You have got everything that you need in Jesus. So that's the primary objective that he is writing. And secondly, as he goes to the second chapter, last week Baya covered about he covered on the verses 1 to 6. So verses 1 to 6 talks about the first test of faith, which we saw in the last week. So those verses emphasize that if you say that you know him, if you say that you are a Christian, you are a follower of Jesus Christ, then you must have obedience to God's commandments. You cannot say that I believe and you don't obey God. It's basically in line with the first commandment that Jesus gave. Love the Lord with all your heart, all your strength and all your might. And Jesus said, if you love me, you will obey me. So that is in line with the first commandment that Jesus gave. If you love Jesus, you will obey his commandments. And if obedience is in your life, you see a growth of obedience to the commandments of Jesus. You can just go to the Ten Commandments, you can go to the teachings of Jesus on the Sermon on the Mount. They are kind of, you know, straightforward commandments of God and Jesus in the Bible. You find it elsewhere also, but that is a core commandments of Jesus. So if we follow that, if we strive to follow that, though we are not perfect, it indicates that we are in the faith. We are in Christ Jesus. We have indeed received the light. So that's what we saw last week. And today we are going to see from verses 7 to 11. Can one of us read 1 John chapter 2 verses 7 to 11? Anyone who's got the mic? Beloved, I am writing to you no new commandment, but an old commandment that you had from the beginning. The old commandment is the word that you have heard. At the same time, it is the new commandment that I am writing to you, which is true in him and in you, because the darkness is passing away and the true light is already shining. Whoever says he is in the light and hates his brother is still in darkness. Whoever loves his brother abides the love, and in him there is no cause for stumbling. But whoever hates his brother is in the darkness and walks in the darkness and does not know where he is going, because the darkness has blinded his eyes.
Yeah.
So second test that John the Apostle gives is again in line with the second commandment that Jesus gives. Love your neighbor as yourself. Love the Lord God and love your neighbor as yourself. So the second test is whether you have brotherly love. Are you showing love towards your brothers and sisters in Jesus Christ? He's saying that is the evidence that we are children of the light. He's comparing light and darkness. If you say that you are in the light, if you say you have received the light, then you will love your brothers and sisters. And then he says, in the first verses 7 and 8, firstly he says it's an old commandment. Then he goes on to say it's a new commandment. So we are going to see what does John mean by saying that brotherly love is an old commandment. And then he goes on to say what is new about it. So we are going to see those two aspects of these verses. So he says, the old commandment is the word that you have heard. An old commandment that you had from the beginning. So when he says from the beginning, he actually means, could mean two things. One thing is from the beginning of creation. That is one sense that he's saying the commandment of love is as old as God, as old as God himself, as ancient as God himself. And it's all the commandment that they first hear as they became Christians. So firstly, we see that love is not new to the New Testament. Though there is new an emphasis about love in the New Testament, we see that from the beginning, the character of God is love. It's one of the supreme attributes of God. Because even before creation, love existed. Where?
Trinity.
God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, that there existed perfect love between them. They love each other so much. And everything that God did, creation of all the things and creation of man, was an expression of love that existed within Trinity. God did not create that he could have someone to love. He already had perfect love in existence between the Trinity. But an outflowing of that love of God led to creation of man. So the very reason God created the world was love. The very reason God created man and woman was love. And the very reason he gave them the commandment not to touch that tree and not eat of its fruit was love. He did not want them to go astray. He wanted them to willingly love him back. And the very reason when God saw that man and woman, Adam and Eve, disobeyed, they ate the fruit, they did not trust God, they trusted the words of Satan. God at that point of time declared that the seed that would be born of the woman would crush the head of the serpent, and it would destroy sin and death in the fallen human race. So God declared that Jesus Christ would be sent, Messiah would be sent, even at that point of time, and that was love. So we can see even from the first beginnings of creation, love of God expressed. So that's why John is saying it's an old commandment. It's something that you know from the beginning. And as you go further in the Old Testament, you see the call of Abraham, and God choose a special people, a nation for himself from the descendants of Abraham, and that he calls his electing love. He showed his special love to those people, the called ones of God. And even when God judged his own people, the judgment of God fell upon things like Sodom and Gomorrah and flooding the whole world during the time of Noah. It was all because of sin, because God's love is a righteous love. But even amidst that, if you see a pattern, if God finds a particular people that they are repentant of their sin, he would not go about to destroy. Even though they were sinning for past so many years, if a prophet is sent and a message is given, and then they repent and turn back in sackcloth and ashes, he relents from the disaster he's going to pour. So that's how compassionate he was. But when there was no repentance, of course, he poured out judgment. Similar thing happened if you read the book of Jonah. City of Nineveh was a sinful city, and Jonah was sent to that city to say, just 40 days, your city will be overthrown. God says, Jonah, go and proclaim the message. He diverts, and then he goes to a different place, and then God again brings him back to Nineveh, and he gives the message. He was not compassionate. Jonah was not compassionate. He just gave the message because God told him to proclaim. He proclaimed, wait 40 days, the city will be overthrown. God is going to judge the city because of your sins. But the people of Nineveh took the message of Jonah to heart. The king of Nineveh declared a fast. Yes, everyone, stop your work. This is serious. Let's go before God. Let's repent. Let's go before him in sackcloth and ashes. And when they did that, in Jonah 4, we read, when God saw what they did, how they turned from their evil ways, God relented of the disaster that he had said he would do to them, and he did not do it. That was God's response. Can one of you read what Jonah's response was? You can see that in Jonah 4, 1 to 3.
Was not this my saying when I was yet in my country? Therefore I fled before unto Tarshish, for I knew that you are a gracious God and merciful, slow to anger and of great kindness, and repentest thee of evil. Therefore now, O Lord, take, I beseech thee, my life from me, for it is better for me to die than to live.
Can you read again the characteristics of God that he is saying?
For I knew that you are gracious God and merciful, slow to anger and of great kindness.
Yeah. So Jonah did not want to go to Nineveh, not because he was afraid to proclaim the message, because he wanted judgment to come upon them. That's what his agenda was. They were sinners, they were not Israelites. God has to judge them. That's why he's running away. I don't want to proclaim the message and see them repenting back, and I know about my God. He's gracious, slow to anger, he will forgive them. Then what will happen to them? Judgment will not come upon them. So that's what he was scared about. He was not scared about going and evangelizing them or telling them the message. It depicts the heart of every human being. He was upset at that point of time. Like a little kid, he went to the mount nearby and he was sitting there saying, God, I'm upset with you. Sometimes we tend to think, believers, that we are more merciful than God. We ask questions like, why does God send people to hell? Why does God judge? You know, but if we think carefully, we'll be sometimes more equal to Jonah than God if you and I are the offended party. If and I are in the place where someone has offended you, someone else has come against you, you'd be more than happy to get them judged than to show them love or mercy, what we read here. So that's why this is an old commandment. And loving your neighbor is also straightforward written in Leviticus. In Leviticus chapter 19, you see in verse 18, it says, you shall not take vengeance or bear a grudge against the sons of your own people, but you shall love your neighbor as yourself. I am the Lord. And you read the 10 commandments that's found in Exodus. Again, you will see the first half will be dedicated to love the Lord your God with all your heart, mind and soul. It's about loving God. The second part, it will all say, do not covet what is others. Do not steal what is others. Do not do bad to others. It's all expression that you love them as yourself. If you love them, you will not do all of that to the other people, right? If you love the other person as yourself, you will not do any harm to them. You will not steal their stuff. You will not lust their stuff. You will not want any harm for them. So that's why this is an old commandment. But why does John, he goes on to say, initially he says this old commandment is a word that you have heard. In verse 8 he says, at the same time, it's a new commandment that I am writing to you, which is true in him and in you, because the darkness is passing away and the true light is already shining. So if it's an old commandment, how come it's a new commandment? It is new in terms of the intensity of its emphasis. Because in Jesus, it's elevated to a more higher plane and level. It's ancient in origin, but there is a new level of expectation from you and me. And with the model of the life of Jesus and the death and the resurrection of Jesus and the new life that you and I have received, it indeed has a new meaning and a new application for you and me as saints of Jesus Christ. Just to illustrate, imagine you find a diamond or any other costly stone. You are digging, exploring, and then you find some costly stone that you find from under the earth. It's ancient. It's old. But because it's covered in rubbish, it's not shining. So you take it out and you give it to the person who polishes it, and you polish it. You scrap all the dirt and muck out of it, and then it shines the splendor. You're bringing out the splendor of the stone out of it. You're not giving the stone a new splendor. You're just bringing out the splendor out by polishing it. So that is what we are seeing here. A fresh shine is given to the old commandment that was from the beginning. And as we read this verse, these verses, you find it's kind of parallel to what Jesus Christ himself said in the Last Supper when he was along with his disciples. In John 13:34 we read, he says, a new commandment I give to you, that you love one another just as I have loved you. You also are to love one another. The new emphasis that Jesus is giving here is, you also ought to love one another. And the Expectation level is, what is that? How you are also supposed to love one another. John 13:34. Just as I have loved you. So love, even in 1 John, the word that is used is agape. The love that we are expected to show to one another must be similar to the love Jesus Christ has shown toward us. Agape love. It's not a love that is in good mood at one time and showers the love to other people, and then another time we get moody and then we are hating. It's not like that. It's like the love of God. It's like the love of Christ Himself. Just as I have loved you. Look at the life of disciples. They were not lovable. Many of the times, Peter, they were all unmature little children at that point of time. That's why He even calls them little children, Jesus Christ. Little children. See, just as I have loved you, love one another. And I see a parallel between John 13 and 1 John 2. So in John 13, Jesus calls His apostles as little children. And in 1 John, we see John the apostle is now calling the disciples in that particular church as little children. And when Jesus was telling these statements, he was the Last Supper, before crucifixion. He was showing His love. Just before that, at the beginning of the chapter, He washed their feet, taught them humility. And now He showed them the extent of His love. So He was at the end of His life. And John, at that point of time, he was an old man. It was the end of the first century. He was probably 90, 100 years old. And he knew that he was going to leave the earth soon. And Jesus and John talks about loving one another as a new commandment. Can you see what's happening here? There's a parallel. What is happening here?
John is becoming more like Jesus.
Exactly. So John is not speaking. Jesus Christ is speaking through John, in a sense. His attitudes are becoming more like Jesus. Jesus is shining through Apostle John. His character, his attitude, all molded and changed. Even his words are becoming more like Jesus. But what was his original personality? Was it like that? Was he a loving person in the beginning? It was not. Let's quickly see. Just to understand John's writing, let's quickly see a character, quick character sketch of John. From what kind of personality he has become like this. So we'll see a couple of verses. So let's firstly read, one of you turn to Matthew chapter 4 and read from verses 18 to 22. Matthew chapter 4, verses 18 to 22.
While walking by the Sea of Galilee, he saw two brothers, Simon, who is called Peter, and Andrew, his brother, casting a net into the sea, for they were fishermen. And he said to them, "Follow me, and I will make you fishers of men." Immediately they left their nets and followed him. And going on from there, he saw two other brothers, James, the son of Zebedee, and John his brother, in a boat which Zebedee their father mending their nets. And he called them. Immediately they left the boat and their father and followed him.
Yeah. So Jesus starts his ministry, and the first people he called were two brothers. First Peter and Andrew. They were first called by Jesus. And then from there, he goes on to call James and John, the sons of Zebedee. All four were fishermen. But they were not poor fishermen. that we see in the coast of cities of India. They were not that poor kind. They were in the fishing business. Because we see they owned the boat and they had hired laborers working for them. We also know that when Jesus was being tried, it was Apostle John who got an entry into the courts of the high priest for Peter. Peter could not move in. So John used his influence and then they were able to go. So they were kind of an influential family. It was in fishing business, the city of Capernaum. But once they were called by Jesus, they immediately left their boat and their father Zebedee and they followed him. When this happened, he was probably very young. He followed him. Of course, he showed immense faith in following Jesus. But his character was not flawless at that point of time. He was young. He probably was in his 20s. Because by the time he wrote 1 John, about 70 plus years have passed. So, if he had lived that long, he must have been in his early 20s at that point of time. Or late 20s, we don't know. And James and John had a nickname. You know what is that? Sons of Thunder. Mark 3:17. Indicating that they were strong-willed and hot-tempered young Jewish men. We see a couple of instances that is evident. Mark. So 3 verses we are going to read. You can have the mic ready. So Mark 9, 38 to 40. We'll first read that.
Said John, we saw a man driving out demons in your name and we told him to stop because he was not one of us. Do not stop him. Jesus said, no one who does a miracle in my name can in the next moment say anything bad about me. For whoever is not against us is for us.
Can you also read verse 54? Sorry, it's not Mark, it's Luke 9:54.
When the disciples James and John saw this, they said, Lord, do you want us to command fire to come down from heaven and consume them just as Elijah did?
We'll also read, lastly, Matthew 20:20-21.
Then the mother of Zebedee's sons came to him
with her sons, kneeling down and asking something from him. And he said to her, what do you want?
Yeah, next one.
She said to him, grant that these two sons of mine may sit, one on your right hand and the other on the left in your kingdom.
Yeah. So, these three verses kind of indicate how his character was indeed rough even when he followed Jesus. In Mark 9, first verse that we read, he was extremely offended when he saw that some other who were not following Jesus were casting out demons in Jesus' name. Saying, we are supposed to do that. We are the ones. We are the one who is following. So, who is that guy? Lord, stop them. And Jesus says, the one who is not against us is for us. So, he was an offended man when someone else is doing what they were supposed to do. And Luke 9:54, he was all ready to call down fire from heaven on the Samaritan village. They did not accept Jesus, so let us bring down fire, let's destroy them. He was all in the Old Testament, you know, Sodom and Gomorrah mood. So, son of thunder, indeed he is. And Matthew 20, we read, he's coming along with his mummy. Recommendation, special seat. One on your left side, one on your right side. This is another indication that he is probably young. You know, who will bring his mummy for recommendation? When was the last time you brought your mother? A kid, no? So he was like still, you know, immature in that sense, and he was looking for a place of honor in Jesus, and he came along with his mother for that recommendation. A rough man. But he was chosen by Jesus to be part of the inner circle. Not only him, also his brother James. So John, James and Peter, they were part of the inner circle of Jesus. So 12 disciples, and there was an inner circle of these three men. So only they were present during certain times of Jesus' life, like the Mount of Transfiguration. Only Jesus took them along. Also when Jesus raised Jairus' daughter, only they were taken along with him into the room. They also had some private mentoring sessions with Jesus. And it was these three that Jesus took when he went to Garden of Gethsemane to pray alone. But more than that, even among this inner circle, it is probably true that he was the closest to Jesus. Even among the three, he was the person who was closest, nearest to Jesus, because he is recorded as the disciple whom Jesus loved. But John is writing that letter himself. But this is probably true, because he was the person who was leaning against the back of Jesus in the Last Supper. And when Jesus said, "One of you is going to betray me," none of them dared to ask the question, "Lord, who is going to do that?" So at that time, Simon Peter signals to John saying, ask him. So they were not daring to ask the question. Even Peter was not asking. Normally he asks the question, right? "Lord, ask me to come on the water," and all of that. He has asked all of the questions, but it's kind of an intense moment, because one of you is going to betray me. I mean, even he did not dare to ask Jesus, "Who is going to betray you?" So he motions to John, and John finally asks Jesus the question. And it is only John the apostle who was present apparently at the crucifixion of Jesus in front of the cross, along with other women, including Mary, the mother of Jesus. So we read in John 19:26-27, as Jesus was about to give his breath out, Jesus declares there, he says to Mary, "Woman, behold your son." And to John, he says, "Behold your mother." So he's giving Mary and John to each other's care. Take care of each other. So that was how close John was to Jesus. So it is that same hot-tempered, strong-willed son of thunder is now writing 1 John, but now he is a very different person. As he said, he is indeed becoming more like Jesus Christ. The person of Jesus is shining through this old apostle, who is probably 80 or 90 plus of age. And now he has got a new nickname. Do you know what is that? Yeah, it's called Apostle of Love. Look, from a son of thunder, hot-tempered, want to bring fire, now he has become a transformed man into an apostle of love. That should be our aim also. When we came into the Christian faith, we all came with rough edges. We don't transform immediately, become the holy apostle of love. We have hot temper, we have anger, we have lust, we struggle with a lot of things. But as we grow and grow and grow and grow in time, we must also grow in maturity, both in obedience and in love. So we see here a man whose heart has been plowed completely. The rough edges of his character, it's all level. The Spirit of God, as if chisel on a rock, all his unchrist-like attitudes in this man. He has been molded as if by the hands of very God. So this is what John wants to happen for all of our lives. He's saying this is the evidence. He's showing with his own life. He's also commanding that this is what you should also suppose to follow, and he is exhorting them to do that. Let's go on to read the verses 8 to 11 in 1 John 2. From there he says, again I'm reading that, at the same time it is a new commandment that I am writing to you, which is true in him and in you, because the darkness is passing away and the true light is already shining. Whoever says he is in the light and hates his brother is still in darkness. Whoever loves his brother abides in the light, and in him there is no cause for stumbling. But whoever hates his brother is in the darkness and walks in the darkness and does not know where he is going, because the darkness has blinded his eyes. So John says, if a person who says, I am in the light, what he is basically saying is, he has been enlightened by the gospel of Jesus Christ. An enlightening has come into the inner man, soul. It also means that you have been made a new creation on the inside by the working of the Spirit of God. And now, because of the light that you have got inside, the inner light that you have got, you have got a new comprehension of the spiritual things of God. Let us see a parallel in John 1, where he again mentions about the light there. So in John 1, if you see from verses 6 to 13,
came as a witness to bear witness about the light, that all might believe through him. He was not the light, but came to bear witness about the light. The true light, which gives light to everyone, was coming into the world. He was in the world, and the world was made through him. Yet the world did not know him. He came to his own, and his own people did not receive him.
So John here uses the word true light to denote Jesus Christ. And he also says this true light is coming into the world to shine that light to everyone, to enlighten every soul who comes to him. So everyone who goes to Jesus, who believes in Jesus, who puts his faith in Jesus, they experience the true light shining to their hearts and enlighten their inner man. And one of the effects of the light of Christ shining in your heart as you become a new creation is the ongoing creation of a new love in your heart. Love, we saw the old commandment as a new emphasis, and it's a perfection of obedience. So that's the ultimate thing that Spirit of God is bringing about in your own heart, creation of a new love, love for God, love for God's children. The moment the light shines upon you, you immediately get that love. But as you grow and grow and grow, the love also grows. You fall in more love with God. You fall in love more with also his children. For that reason, John says, if a person who says, I am a Christian, harbors hatred in his heart against a brother or sister, he is still in darkness. Because you have not got the light, you have not got the new love created in your heart. Your mind is not truly enlightened by the gospel. You see, basically, you are not Christian in the first place if you are harboring hatred against brothers and sisters in your heart. And not only that, the person who hates his brother John says, not only causes problem for other people whom he is hating, John says he is actually hurting his own life. The person who hates is hurting his own life, because firstly, he says, the person who's hating, his eyes has been blinded. The reason he is hating is, he's blind, not able to see, because he's not in the light, he's in the darkness. Being blind means you don't understand spiritual things at all. You lack spiritual understanding. And 2 Corinthians 4:4, we read, unbelievers are all blinded from understanding the truth by Satan himself. And hatred in your heart towards brothers is a sign that we are under the power of Satan. Because he's the first person, he'll be the person who will be first in line to hate God and hate God's children. So basically, if we say, or if you have a hatred, basically going to the side of Satan, you're jumping to his band. And in a sense, you are giving power to the devil over your own lives, to control your lives by harboring hatred in your hearts. That's what John is saying. If you hate, you are blind. And that blindness is done by Satan himself. You are willingly giving him power over your life. And if he is blind, John says, naturally, he will not be able to walk properly. He will stumble in his path, John says. His spiritual walk, or no matter what he is walking toward, he will not be able to walk straight because he can't see. And stumbling is an indication that he will repeatedly fall into sin. He'll repeatedly fall into multiple other sins, not just hatred. It's a starting point maybe. But he'll fall into all the other sins. And sin will dominate this person's life. And he will live a defeated life, and not an overcomer. That's what we want to ask ourselves. Is hatred that probably sometimes we are harboring in our hearts, is it leading to sinful tendencies in our own lives? And then thirdly, John the Apostle says, because of his blindness, because he is stumbling along the way, because he is in the darkness, he does not even know where he is going. Just imagine, I want to go to Delhi. I know where to book the ticket. I know where to go to the station, and I know where to board. I know where to get down. Because I know where I am going. But a person who is blind, who does not have any guide, just thinks that he just can walk in any direction and he can reach Delhi, he will not be able to do that. So that person will not know where he is going, will completely lack clarity about his future. And especially he will lack clarity about his eternal destiny. He will not even know whether he is going to heaven or hell. He will not have any assurance of salvation because he is in darkness. So we see this is a serious commandment. Neither Jesus nor John is saying try to love others. He is not saying try to love others. He is giving a new commandment. It's an old commandment, but a new emphasis, a new stress is given to you guys. You ought to love each other just as I have loved you. And this love is not some emotional love in our hearts, but this is a love that acts. We read in James, but James says, you know, you see a brother come, and then the brother is in need, and you say, I'll pray for you, brother, go in peace. And he's saying, you are not actually having love, though you seem to have love. Your love is not acting out in obedience. You don't actually love that person. Will you do the same if that person is your own son or father? Again, Jesus, when he had to explain about the second commandment of love your neighbor as yourself, he's giving the illustration of Good Samaritan. Again, a person is lying on the road, needy, and then the Good Samaritan goes and helps him, takes him to the hospital, goes an extra mile. So that's the question that we need to ask ourselves. Is your love for others going an extra mile? Then it's true love. Is it costing you? Costing your time, costing your energy, costing your money? And if you have to indeed love like Jesus, you know what is the length that we have to go? We're not there, but we ought to be there. Because Jesus, just as I have loved you, you ought to love each other. And the true love is that a person is ready to lay down your life for your brothers. So in conclusion, let us take these exhortations from the Apostle John, the one whose own life has transformed from being a hot-tempered man to being an apostle of love. And let's be watchful of our hearts for any hatred that's harboring in our own hearts, in our own lives. 1 Corinthians 10:12 says, therefore let anyone who thinks he stands take heed lest he fall. So let's not think I'm of course loving. No, let's take stock of our lives. Let's watch our hearts for any element of harboring of hatred in our hearts, even small. We can ask the question, am I able to truly pray for a blessing over that person? Am I truly able to bless that person in any way possible without having any disturbance in my heart? Will I go an extra mile for that person? And this is just the beginning of the life of love that Jesus Christ is calling us to live. Because indeed, if you truly follow the Sermon on the Mount, the expectation is even beyond. Here we are just talking about loving our neighbor, brothers in Christ, but the expectation is even beyond. He says, love your enemies, love those who hate you. If you have to go to that level, we have to start here. This is a basic expectation. This is the true commandment that Jesus is giving us. So let's allow the love of Christ to rule our hearts and minds. And let's set targets that we practically love and the opportunities that are before us, that we truly transform and become more like Jesus. Amen. Let's bow our heads. Let's pray that God will indeed make this true in our lives. Father, I want to commit this time into your hands, Master Lord Jesus. Indeed, your word is clear that these are the two greatest commandments that we have to see applied in our lives. Lord, we confess that we are weak, we are frail, we are sinful. I pray, Master Lord Jesus, that you would help us to walk in the light, to walk in love. I pray, Father Lord Jesus, that you would help us to obey you in all that you have commanded us, so that the love of Christ might be perfected in our hearts. Oh Lord, I pray that every day, as you pour out new mercy and grace into our hearts, I pray that through the Holy Spirit, that you would pour out fresh love into our hearts, that we can share that love with other people that we meet. That we will not be people who expect love, but you will be givers of love. For you said it is better to give than to receive. I pray, Master Lord, help us to set our expectations on a higher level. Set our targets on a higher level to love more, to serve more, to see to that love is practical in our lives, that we will not deceive ourselves. I pray and commit ourselves, Master Lord Jesus, truly mold us and change us to become more like Jesus. We commit ourselves to your hands, Father Lord. In Jesus' name we ask and pray.
Amen.